In this video, we are going to be able to differentiate between rational and irrational and what that means in terms of numbers. To do this, let's learn about irrational numbers and what they are. Throughout the video, there will be instances where you are asked to pause and answer a question that has been posed. Doing so by either writing down your answers or organizing the thoughts in your head will allow you to reflect on the questions and move through the video. It will also serve as an opportunity for you to solidify your understanding of the content that is being presented in the video. For an activator, you are asked to complete a short practice quiz on MyMCPS Classroom. The purpose of the activator is to get us thinking about what it takes to square a number and to multiply fractions. If you have not completed the activator on MyMCPS Classroom, pause the video, visit your MyMCPS Classroom page, and the quiz will be attached to the module under the screencast. Use this time to complete the quiz. After you finish the quiz, you can check your answers below. Keeping in mind that for fractions, when I'm trying to find the square root of a fraction, I need to think of the factors for both the numerator and the denominator. For example, a squared equals 49 25ths. I first need to think, what is the square root of 49, which would be 7, and what is the square root of 25, which is 5. So therefore, my square root of 49 25ths would be 7 fifths. You can apply this logic to all fractions. Let's jump into our first activity. You're going to be given three squares that are split into four sections, and each square has 9 vertices. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. For this activity, draw three squares of different sizes with the vertices aligned to the vertices of the grid. For each square, label the area, label the side length, and write an equation that shows the relationship between the side length and the area. Here are some non-examples that would not satisfy the directions of the assignment. This has vertices aligned to the grid, as you can see, but it is not a square. This looks like a square, but does not have the vertices aligned to the grid, as the vertices of this square do not touch any of the vertices on the grid paper. Take a minute, pause the video, and see if you can come up with three squares of different sizes. Now that you've had some time to look it over, let's take a look at the three different squares. The first square would be if you trace the lines on the outside. We would have side lengths of 2, an area of 4, and we could prove this by saying that 2 squared, or 2 times 2, is equal to 4. Perfect. Our second one, you could take any of the quadrants and make a small square. We would have side lengths of 1 and an area of 1. And we could prove this again by saying 1 squared, or 1 times 1, is equal to 1. Lastly, the third square would be similar to the non-example, but if you extended the square so that the vertices touched on the corners. If we take a look at this square, you'll notice that each quadrant of our grid is essentially split in half. Therefore, each quadrant is filled up with half of a square. If I added all those parts together, 1/2, 1/2, 1/2, 1/2, I would have 4/2, which means that the area inside the square would simplify to 2. Thinking back to our previous video, I know that if the area of the inside of the square is 2, that means that the side length of the square has to be the square root of 2. And we could prove that by saying that the square root of 2 squared equals 2, which is true. At this point, I'm sure you're thinking, yeah, that's great, I know what the side length is, but what is the square root of 2 actually equal? We're going to figure that out. Using the same idea as the warm-up, we're going to try some numbers and see if they equal to 2 if we were to square them. So go ahead again, pause the video, and use the numbers that are given to you here and see if you plug them into this equation, x squared equals 2, would these numbers satisfy the equation? Now that you've taken some time to check these numbers, we're going to justify your answers and then place them on the number line to see if we can approximate where the square root of 2 actually is. Let's start with 1. Would 1 squared equal 2? No, of course not. We know that 1 squared is simply 1 times 1, which equals 1. So that would not work. What about 1 half? If we are squaring a fraction, again, we're multiplying the numerator times the numerator and the denominator times the denominator. So 1 half times 1 half is actually going to make a smaller fraction of 1 fourth. So 1 half is taking us in the wrong direction. We've gone from 1 to 1 fourth. How about 3 halves? Again, keeping that same idea in mind, numerator times numerator, denominator times denominator, if I were to multiply 3 halves by 3 halves, I would get 9 fourths. 9 fourths is too big, keeping in mind that the value of 2 is equivalent to 8 fourths. So 3 halves is a little bit too big. What about 7 fifths? 7 fifths is between 1 and 3 halves. It's about 1.4. If I was to square 7 fifths, I would do 7 times 7 to get 49, and 5 times 5 to get 25. I would have 49 25ths. We're incredibly close, but we're still not exactly at 2. 2 is equivalent to 50 25ths. So we are 1 25th away from being exactly at the square root of 2. So none of these numbers work. The reason for that is because all of the numbers that we tried, 1, 1 half, 3 halves, 7 fifths, are all examples of rational numbers. Let's review what a rational number is. A rational number is any number that can be written as a fraction or a ratio of two integers. So any number that we can take and turn into a fraction is an example of a rational number. Here are some examples. 7/6, 6/3, negative 1/3 are all already fractions, so those are for sure rational numbers. Decimals, like 2/10, can be written as 2 over 10 or 1 over 5, so this is also a rational number. Whole numbers can be written as a value over 1, so those will satisfy as well. Even negative numbers, I can still take negative 5 and write it as negative 5 over 1. That's a fraction. In terms of square roots, the square root of 9 is simply 3 because 3 squared is 9, and I can write 3 as a fraction. So the square root of 9 works. I can also have square roots in a fraction. The square root of 16 is 4, and the square root of 100 is 10. 4 tenths is a fraction. Even with the negative sign of negative 4 tenths, this is still a fraction, so this would satisfy the equation. So what about the square root of 2? Is there a fraction in existence that is equivalent to the square root of 2? We know that there is no whole number that we could square to get 2, because 1 squared is 1 and 2 squared is 4. So there is no whole number that we could square that gets us to 2. That makes the square root of 2 a non-perfect square, which means that there is no known ratio that I could square to get the square root of 2. I can get incredibly close, like we saw with 7 fifths, we were only 1 25th off. However, non-perfect squares are known as irrational numbers. Think of it this way. If a rational number is any number that can be written as a fraction or as a ratio, then an irrational number is a number that we cannot write as a fraction. Another way we can think about rational and irrational numbers is if we group the types of numbers that we know. Rational numbers include all integers, positive or negative, proper fractions, terminating decimals. What a terminating decimal is a decimal that ends or has an endpoint or would have zeros trailing on at the end of it. And perfect squares and cubes. For example, the square root of 16 would equal 4, and the cube root of 8 would equal 2, because 2 times 2 times 2 is 8. Irrational numbers would be our non-perfect squares and cubes. There is no whole number that I can square to get 11. There is no whole number that I can cube to get 4. Therefore, these are non-perfect squares and cubes and are irrational. Another example of irrational numbers are non-terminating decimals, or decimals that go on forever. For example, 2.214 with the three dots at the end. The dots means that the decimal continues on forever with no pattern. Therefore, it would be impossible for us to write it as a fraction. Another incredibly famous irrational number is pi. Pi is a decimal that does not end. It is non-terminating. Therefore, there is no way that we could write pi as a fraction. However, just like the square root of 2, we can use a fraction to approximate what pi is, which is why we use 22 over 7. But we know that 22 over 7 is not the exact value of pi. In this video, we have learned the difference between a rational number and an irrational number. A rational number is a fraction, or the opposite of a fraction. Some examples are included below. An irrational number is a number that is not a fraction and cannot be written as a fraction. For example, we saw that the square root of 2 is an example of an irrational number. Pi, being a decimal that goes on forever without a pattern, is also an example of an irrational number. You may use this video as a reference when completing your assignments for the remainder of the week.